Welcome to a video on determining a geometric power series to represent a function, part 1. And the goals of this video are to determine a geometric series that represents a function, as well as determine the interval of convergence. Remember, if we have an infinite geometric series, we can determine the sum if the absolute value of r is less than 1. So if we have a geometric series in this form, where the absolute value of r is less than 1, remember the infinite sum is equal to a, which is the first term, divided by the quantity 1 minus r. So to write a geometric series for a given function, we'll write the function in the form of f of x equals a divided by the quantity 1 minus r, where r will be some expression in terms of x. Once we have it in this form, we can identify r and a, and therefore write the geometric series in this form. Now, if the power series is not centered at x equals 0, we will have to replace x with x minus c and then undo the addition or subtraction. Let's take a look at an example of the basic idea. Notice this function here matches the exact form of the formula for the infinite sum. So since the function is in this form, we know that a, the first term, must equal 1, and r would be equal to x. Therefore, the infinite geometric series that would represent this function would be the summation from n equals 0 to infinity of a, which we already identified as 1, times r to the power of n, but our r is equal to x. Of course, we can simplify this to the summation of x to the power of n. Now, to determine the interval of convergence, remember that the absolute value of r must be less than 1. So this will converge as long as the absolute value of x is less than 1. And since this power series is centered at x equals 0, the interval of convergence will be from 0 minus 1 all the way to 0 plus 1, which would be on the open interval from negative 1 to positive 1. So here is our infinite geometric series to represent the function. And here is the interval of convergence. Let's take a look at this graphically. Here we see the original function graphed in red and the first four terms of the power series graphed in blue. And we can see that right around x equals 0, where this power series is centered, the blue function is a very good approximation of the red function. Now, a lot of times the function will not be in this exact form, so we do have to manipulate the function to make it fit the formula for the sum of an infinite geometric series. For example, on this function, it does not fit the form of a divided by 1 minus r in its current form, so we have to make the function fit this form. So the first thing we should notice is it has to be in the form of 1 minus r, so we have to rewrite this so that we're subtracting x. So we could rewrite this as 2 divided by 4 minus a negative x, and notice these are still equal. The next thing we have to recognize is that we have to have 1 minus r on the denominator. So we're going to have to divide everything by 4 to make it fit this form. So we can divide this by 4 as long as we divide this by 4 and also the numerator by 4. So this will equal 1 half in the numerator, and then our denominator will have the 1 that we needed minus a negative x over 4. So in this form, we can identify all of the important information that we need, meaning a, or the first term, will be equal to 1 half, and r will be negative x over 4. So now we can write the power series to represent this function. We'll have the summation from n equals 0 to infinity of a, which is 1 half, times r to the power of n, and r is equal to negative x over 4. So this is the power series to represent this function when it's centered at x equals 0. But we can clean this up a little bit, meaning we could factor out negative 1 to the power of n and put that as the numerator here, and then rewrite this as x over 4. Now, to determine the interval of convergence, remember that the absolute value of r must be less than 1. So we have the absolute value of negative x divided by 4 must be less than 1. We could factor out the 1/4 and then multiply both sides by 4. So this tells us that x must be greater than negative 4 and less than 4. So the interval of convergence would be the open interval from negative 4 to positive 4. Again, here we have our infinite geometric series, and here we have our interval of convergence. And let's go ahead and look at the graph of this one as well. We have the original function in red and the geometric power series in blue, and I graph the first 4 terms of the infinite geometric series, and you can clearly see that the blue function is a good approximation of the red function when the values are close to x equals 0. Let's go and take a look at one more for this video, and then we'll take a look at some more challenging problems in part 2. The first thing we should notice about this example is that it's centered at x equals 1. So we have to replace x with x minus 1. Let's start by doing that. Now, when we replaced x with x minus 1, if we distribute this 2, we just subtracted 2 from the denominator. So to undo that, we're going to have to add 2 as well. So the net result would be the same. So let's go ahead and rewrite this again. We're going to have 6. Notice we have 3 here. And then we'll go ahead and rewrite this as minus a negative 2 times the quantity x minus 1. Remember, it does have to be subtraction, so we can subtract a negative, and the result will still be the same. The last thing we have to deal with is that the denominator must be in the form of 1 minus r. So this 3 has to be a 1, so now we'll divide everything by 3. And now we should have the form that we need. This is going to be equal to 2 in the numerator divided by 1 minus, and this is going to be negative 2/3 times the quantity x minus 1. In this form, we can tell a is equal to 2, and r will equal all of this, negative 2/3 times the quantity x minus 1. So our infinite geometric series will be a, which is 2, times r raised to the power of n, and r is negative 2/3 times the quantity x minus 1. And we can manipulate this formula if we wanted to. We'd have the summation from n equals 0 to infinity. We could factor out a negative 1 to the power of n. And then notice we'd have n factors of 2 and then another factor of 2 here. So we could rewrite the numerator as 2 to the power of n plus 1. And then we still have n factors of x minus 1. And our denominator would have n factors of 3. These formulas are equal to each other. This one looks a lot more like what the book would provide. Okay, and then lastly, to determine the interval of convergence, we know the opposite value of r must be less than 1. Here's our value of r, so we have the opposite value of negative 2/3 times the quantity x minus 1 must be less than 1. So let's go ahead and factor out the 2/3. Now we'll multiply both sides by the reciprocal. So this absolute value must be less than 3/2. So that tells us that x minus 1 must be greater than negative 3/2 and less than 3/2. So now if we add 1, we should have our interval of convergence. We'll have x must be greater than negative 3/2 plus 1, that's negative 1/2. And then 3/2 plus 1 would be 5/2. So this power series will converge on the open interval from negative 1/2 to positive 5/2. So again, here we have our infinite geometric series, and here we have our interval of convergence. Okay, that's going to do it for this video. We'll take a look at some additional examples in part 2. Thank you for watching.